In this video, we're tackling a multi-part problem with a block sliding up and down a ramp with friction. So in our initial state here, we have a speed of 2.75 meters per second up the ramp. Now, it's a really common mistake for students to assume that there's still a force pointing up the ramp, but there are no forces pointing up the ramp at this point. We've launched this thing by pushing it up the ramp, but we have already let go. So our initial velocity is 2.75 and the block is slowing down. So in part A, we're going to find the acceleration on the way up the ramp. In part B, we get the maximum sliding distance up the ramp. In part C, we find the maximum static friction coefficient so that the block will still break loose and turn around and come back down the ramp. And then on the next slide, in part D, we get the acceleration on the way down the ramp. And finally, in part E, we get the total time for the block to slide all the way up, turn around, and come back to where it started. In part A, we want to get the magnitude of the acceleration on the way up the ramp. So we have to start getting forces into the diagram. And of course, gravity points straight down. So there's our force of gravity, mg. And we can actually just put a number on this because the mass is given to us. That's 0.7 kilograms. That gives me 6.86 newtons. Then we decompose this force of gravity into the standard parallel and perpendicular components. And I'll post a link to the video where this was first worked out. And it turns out the angle between the vertical and the perpendicular is the same as the angle of incline for the ramp, which was 19 degrees here. And that means our perpendicular component of the force of gravity is going to be an mg cosine of the angle. And I can go ahead and plug in the numbers here. Mg is 6.86 newtons and the angle is 19 degrees. And this gives us about 6.486 newtons for the perpendicular component of gravity. Now the component parallel pointing down the ramp, that's an mg sine theta. And this gives us about 2.233 newtons pointing down the ramp. Now the next thing we have to figure out is the friction force, and that's mediated by the normal force. So we'll pop in the normal force vector. And that normal force does exactly what it has to in order to balance all the perpendicular forces in the problem. That's going to guarantee that our block stays constrained to the surface of the ramp. Well, there's only one other force acting perpendicular, and that's the perpendicular component of gravity. And that was about 6.486 newtons. So there's our normal force. Now we get in our friction force. And of course, that opposes the direction of the sliding. And that kinetic friction force, Fk, is given by the coefficient of kinetic friction times the normal force. We're given the coefficient of kinetic friction. That was 0.12. So we take 0.12 times our normal force. And we get a friction force of about 0.788 newtons. So that pretty much completes the force analysis on the way up the ramp. And now we can get into the first part of the problem. We want the magnitude of the acceleration on the way up. Now all the forces are pointed down the ramp. So that's the direction of our acceleration. And we have an object sliding up the ramp and slowing down. I'm going to go ahead and use down the ramp as the positive direction. And we simply apply Newton's second law here. So I could write A equals F net over M. And so the plan is to call all the forces down the ramp positive, the acceleration comes out positive. And what we're asked for here is a magnitude for the acceleration anyway, so that's convenient. Now the net force down the ramp, I have my friction force of about 0.788 newtons. I have my parallel component of gravity, 2.233 newtons. And then the size of the mass, 0.7 kilograms. Into three significant digits, I get a magnitude of my acceleration of about 4.32 meters per second squared. In part B, I'm asked for the maximum distance this mass is going to travel up the ramp before it comes to a stop. So this is a constant acceleration kinematics problem. Remember, I had a positive velocity up the ramp of 2.75 meters per second at the beginning of the problem. Now I'm going to call up the ramp positive, which means my acceleration has to have a minus sign on it because it's going down the ramp. That's negative 4.32 meters per second squared. And when we're looking for the maximum sliding distance before the block turns around, well, at that point of maximum distance, it's turning around. And that means V is equal to zero at that point. Now we're going to apply our time-independent kinematics equation. V squared equals V naught squared plus 2A times the displacement X minus X naught. We're going to call the initial position zero. So that's gone. And our final velocity to get to the turning point, our final velocity has got to be zero. So we plug in our initial velocity, 2.75. Our acceleration, and I'll just pull the minus sign out in front here, negative 2 times 4.32. And the only unknown left is the final x position, which was called d in the diagram. So we subtract 2.75 squared from both sides, divide by the coefficient of d. and we get a maximum sliding distance of 0.875 meters, which you might want to call 87.5 centimeters. Next, in part C, we're looking for the maximum coefficient of static friction, for which the mass will still break loose and turn around after it slides to its maximum distance. So we'll go ahead and redraw our box up at its highest point and do a force analysis up there. And most of these vectors are the same as what we had before. They're still mg pulling straight down. It's still broken into components by the same trick of using 19 degrees for this angle. And so the components of gravity come out the same, roughly speaking, 6.486 for the perpendicular component, 2.233 for the parallel component. This means the normal force is still 6.486 newtons. But this time we have the stationary box, and it's trying to overcome static friction to break loose and come back down the ramp. Well, if you imagine the static friction force successfully holding this thing in place, it becomes very clear the static friction force points up the ramp. It's trying to fight that parallel component of gravity. So there's our static friction force, and again, that's mediated by the normal force. It's given by mu s times the normal force. Now what I've done here is assume the static friction force is at its maximum value. That's the only time you can use that formula, mu s times the normal force. So this is going to give us that cut point where we barely have a big enough force of static friction to hold the object in place. It gives us an upper bound on the static friction coefficient before the object breaks loose. So at this cut point, we're still in equilibrium and the forces are balanced parallel on this ramp. And it's worth looking at this one in a general symbolic way just because the answer is so nice. My force of gravity down the ramp, mg sine theta, is balanced by my static friction force, which is right at its maximum possible value right now, at a mu s times normal force, which was mg cosine theta. Our mg's cancel out, so rather than using the approximate numbers in the diagram, this is such a beautiful symbolic solution, I have to do it in general. So I divide by cosine theta on both sides, that gives me a tangent theta equals mu s, and this means our maximum static friction coefficient is the tangent of 19 degrees. Into three significant digits, that's about 0.344. All right, so now we know the conditions under which this block is going to break loose and slide down the ramp. In the last two parts of the problem, we analyze the motion down the ramp. So here's our initial setup to the problem. Let's go ahead and pop in the block on its way back down. And then we need to get all the forces into the diagram. So those are our same familiar components and our same normal force. Now we have to think carefully about which way does the kinetic friction force point on the way back down the ramp. And if it's sliding down the ramp, the kinetic friction force points back up the ramp. And remember, we compute that by taking mu k times the normal force. So plugging in mu k and then our normal force up here is already known. Again, our kinetic friction force is about 0.788 newtons up the ramp. And now we can get our acceleration again using Newton's second law. So a is equal to f net over m. I can see my acceleration is down the ramp because that parallel component of gravity exceeds the force of kinetic friction. So I'm just going to use down the ramp as positive again. I have 2.233 newtons for the parallel component of gravity, pointing down the ramp, minus a 0.788 newtons for the force of kinetic friction pointing up the ramp. And again, our mass is 0.7. This gives me an acceleration of 2.06 meters per second squared on the way down. Finally, in part E, we want to get the total time, so the round trip time, for this block to slide up the ramp and turn around and come all the way back to where it started. And just to summarize the relevant information that we've figured out so far, on the way up, our acceleration had a magnitude of 4.32 meters per second squared. On our way down, because the direction of the friction force reversed, we had a different acceleration, still pointing down the ramp, but with a smaller magnitude of 2.06 meters per second squared. And the total slide distance in each direction was 0.875 meters. Now to get the time on the way up the ramp before it came to a stop, well, we know the initial velocity and we know the acceleration, so we can use our second kinematics equation like this, v equals v naught plus at. Our final velocity for the slide up the ramp is zero because we're just trying to get to the turning point. Our initial velocity was 2.75 meters per second. Acceleration was a negative 4.32. If we count the velocity as positive, then the acceleration points the opposite direction. And this gives me a time of about 0.637 seconds. On the way back down, I know my initial velocity is zero, and I know the total sliding distance is that same 0.875 meters. So the simplest way to attack this one is to use our first kinematics equation, x equals x naught plus v naught t plus 1/2 at squared. And I'll just call down the ramp positive for this, and I'll call the initial position zero. My initial velocity was zero, and I have my distance down the ramp, 0.875. is equal to 1/2 times my acceleration on the way down, that was 2.06 times t squared. That leaves t as the only unknown there, and we can quickly solve for that. Just multiply both sides by 2, divide by 2.06, and square root the result. And this gives me about 0.922 seconds on the way back down. Now all we have to do is add up these two times, and the total round trip time for this block turns out to be 1.56 seconds. And we're done. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.